I'll call the meeting to order. This is meeting number 8 of the year 1991. I'm going to welcome you all to the town council meeting. We'll have the roll call by the clerk, please.
Chairman Cogsall.
Here.
Councilor Amaro.
Here.
Councilor Creelman.
Here.
Councilor Jordan.
Yep.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Here.
Councilor Pearson.
Here.
And Councilor Reed.
Here.
The minutes of meeting number 7 for 1991 held on October 10th. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes? If not, I'll take a motion on the minutes from last meeting.
Move acceptance, Madam Chairman.
Second.
All in favor? The next item is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there any citizen who'd like to come forward and make a comment? There being none, we'll go to one of my favorite parts of our meeting, special presentations. Councilor McLaughlin. The town council periodically presents resolutions and plaques to various organizations and citizens of the town who have done exceptionally well. The first presentation tonight is to the Cape Elizabeth Lions Club. Recently, the club made substantial donations to the Cape Elizabeth Water Extrication Team and to the Town Dare Program. The town council wishes to recognize this Lions Club by awarding them a plaque for these special efforts. In doing so, I also wish to know other accomplishments of this club. The Lions Club has provided funds and labor for an expansion of the Thomas Memorial Library in the 1980s. They donated Lions Field to the town for recreational enjoyment of all of us. Each year, they're generous with scholarships for graduating seniors, tuitions to Boys and Girls State, and with providing assistance to the needy at Thanksgiving. The Lions also provided assistance to the rescue over the years and to the Quest program at the Cape Elizabeth Schools and to countless other good causes in our community. One particularly notable accomplishment was the restoration of the Bowery Beach Schoolhouse, one of the oldest public buildings in the town of Cape Elizabeth. So on behalf of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, thank you, Lions Club, for all you've done for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. Is there a representative of the Lions Club?
On behalf of the Cape Elizabeth Lions, a group, international group, that are really that we have to be or are told to be and are being visual in the community and doing everything we possibly can to help the town and help needy people, we'll continue this endeavor. And we thank the town of Cape Elizabeth very much for this recognition, and we will continue to do everything we possibly can for the town. Thank you very much.
Do we have the boys' golf team present? Coach Don Richards, is he here?
Some of the golf.
Whoever's here from the golf team, please come forward. You are
Chris.
Congratulations. The town council wishes to present you with this resolution. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School boys golf team recently won the Western Maine Class B championship, and whereas the team completed its successful season with a record of 12 wins and but one loss, and whereas the golfers displayed sportsmanship on the links and improved their drives, pitching and putting, and whereas all the citizens of Cape Elizabeth are proud of the skill and dedication shown by these young men, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and Town Council Assemble does hereby congratulate the Western Maine Class B Championship Cape Elizabeth Boys Golf Team, and we thank them for representing our community so well. Dated this 14th day of November 1990 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, and signed by all the councilors.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The golf team would like to thank the Town Council for this recognition, and hopefully we'll wish my guys good luck for next year. Thank you.
The soccer team and Coach Andy Strauss, are you all here? Could you come forward, please? If you could turn, face the camera so those at home can see you. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School boys soccer team recently won its fifth consecutive Western Maine Class A soccer championship, and whereas the team completed another successful season with a record of 14 wins, 3 losses, and 1 tie, and whereas the players displayed true sportsmanship throughout the season and served as models to many younger soccer players in Cape Elizabeth, and whereas all the citizens of Cape Elizabeth are proud of the tenacity and dedication shown by these young men, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and Town Council Assembled does hereby congratulate the Western Maine Class A soccer champions, and we thank them for representing our community so well. Dated this 14th day of November 1990 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, and signed by all the councilors.
We'd just like to thank the Town Council for this recognition, and also like to thank Andy Stroud, especially the seniors, because it's really nice as a senior to be able to extend your season, you know, to play every possible game and have it last as long as you can. And we'd just like to thank him for making this possible.
The Cape Elizabeth community team, is there a representative here? We also have a resolution for this group that have done so much for the town. Janet Hoskins is the representative. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth community team was formed to resolve issues related to the consequences of the inappropriate use of alcohol and other drugs, and whereas substance abuse is a pervasive problem that affects all communities and all segments of society, whereas the presence of drugs and narcotics in our society has resulted in innumerable problems of human, community, social, and economic dimensions, and whereas the Cape Elizabeth community team is seeking a better understanding of the problem in order to improve the quality of all our lives, now therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and Town Council Assembled does hereby salute the efforts of the Cape Elizabeth community team and pledge our support of the very important work the team undertakes. Dated this 14th day of November, 1990, at Cape Elizabeth, Maine.
My thanks to the Town Council for this recognition. It was a surprise. I didn't know it was coming. And just if I could tell everyone that we're doing an education and awareness tomorrow evening at the high school library for parents of high school freshmen or college-age seniors to help them realize what comes home from college and the kinds of issues that they might be facing. So thank you very much.
Field hockey team, it's your turn. You can get in front of each other or something. We want you all on camera. Squeeze in.
Camera, you can.
As you can see, we have a very good representation from the field hockey team tonight. This is one team, when the coaches speak, sometimes they do listen and they show up. I'm going to take a couple of minutes bragging rights with this team, having sat through some of their long, cold games and watched them in their joy and their suffering. I want you to know that these girls have really had quite a year this year. They know what it's like to be on the good side and win, and how much fun that is and how good it feels. They also know the pain and the frustration of losing and how very hard it is to put that ball into the opponent's net. I think it's one of the hardest things for them, certainly one of the hardest things for their coaches to watch, and also for their spectators. This team started out the year with a record of 2-4. And some people just thought that's the way the year was going to go. But they managed to gel and come together as a team, and for the second year in a row, to be the Western Maine Class B champions.
That was a very nice accomplishment. We're very proud of all of you. So from the council, we have a resolution. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School girls field hockey team recently won the Western Maine Class B Field Hockey Championship for the second consecutive year, and whereas the team improved over the entire season and excelled in defeating teams that were higher seeded, and whereas the players enhanced their skills and showed true sportsmanship throughout a very competitive season, and whereas all of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth are proud of the tenacity and dedication shown by these young women, now, therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and Town Council assembled does hereby congratulate the Western Maine Class B Championship Cape Elizabeth Field Hockey Team, and we thank them for representing our community so well. Dated this 14th day of November, 1990, at Cape Elizabeth, Maine.
On behalf of the field hockey team, I'd like to thank the town council for this recognition. This was really great. We'd also like to thank the Boosters Club. They just started this year, and without their support, we couldn't have come this far. And we'd also like to thank our two great coaches, Coach Hoskin and Coach Weatherby, for bringing us this far, because without them, we really would not have been Western Maine champions. Thank you.
Are there any other people from the public who wish to make a comment, a brief one? If you come to the microphone, please, and identify yourself.
Following the, we call him the King Lion of the Cape Elizabeth Lions Club, and Councillor Cogshaw stole some of my thunder because I was going to mention some of the projects that the Cape Lions have performed just in recent months.
Would you like to tell us who you are?
Pardon?
Would you like to tell us who you are?
Oh, I'm sorry. Frank Potenzo. Okay. Councillor Cogshaw already mentioned the Quest program, which the Cape Lions have donated over $5,000 to the school program. The DARE program, $1,200. The WET team, $1,500. Cape Elizabeth High School scholarship, $1,000. The rescue unit, purchase of training films last year and this year, 12 films each year for over $1,700. The Matthew Johnson Liver Fund, over $1,000. Maine Center for the Blind, Visually Impaired, $500. A relief fund, this is something you may not know, a relief fund of $200 was set up by the Lions Club for burned out victims in Cape Elizabeth to help out. Used and old eyeglasses, receptacles have been set up at the IGA and the town hall. So anyone that has unusable eyeglasses, appreciate it if you'd donate them to the Lions Club to be recycled all over the world. Sponsorship of recipients to Derigo Boys and Girls State and the Hugh O'Brien Youth Center Seminar. American Diabetes Camp, $350. Lions Club International Foundation, worldwide, every Lions Club donates funds to this organization, and in turn they use the funds for relief in disaster areas all over the entire world. Lions Food Trailer, which is being put to good use as an accessory to town functions where we dispense food. Scouting for Food, November 10th and 17th. Picking up canned goods and whatever to be dispersed later for the holidays to needy families. The Bowery Beach Schoolhouse, the renovation of it, the utilization of it. Several nonprofit organizations meet there on a weekly basis at no charge. We have a rental fee for family gatherings, wedding receptions, continual restoration of the schoolhouse, and in most recent project, collection of old photographs of graduating classes of youngsters who went to school there. There are still 7 or 8 people living in Cape Elizabeth who went to school there. And more service to the community regarding Family Fun Day, Lions Field, helping the needy. We have hospital-type equipment that can be loaned out to people, and much, much more. And I thank you for that.
Thank you, Mr. Potenza. Definitely a very important group in our community. Next item, I'm going to ask Mrs. Pizzo if she would give us a brief update on the elections last Tuesday.
Thank you. The general and special municipal election that was held on November 6th was a success. We had 5,008 voters, which is a 65% voter turnout. I would like to thank my election warden, Henry Adams, my deputy town clerk, Jackie Coy, the Board of Voter Registration, and the ballot clerks for all their support and their assistance. It was a very long day, but as I said before, it was a success, and we'll hope for a high voter turnout in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Reports and correspondence. Councilor Amaro.
Yes, I want to report on a meeting that I attended at the South Portland Public Library last week on regional problem solving. It was a meeting sponsored or arranged by the Commission to Evaluate County and Regional Government. This is the special commission that's been set up by the Cumberland County commissioners to look at our form of county government and to ask the following questions. Should regional county government continue to exist? And if so, what functions should be carried out by this level of government as opposed to local or state government? Are the boundaries of Cumberland County as they currently exist still appropriate for regional government in this area? Is the current structure of Cumberland County government appropriate for regional governments, both now and in the future? How should regional county government be funded? Is there a better method of funding than the property tax? And finally, what legal changes are necessary to implement any suggestions made? This particular meeting, we heard a presentation by William Dodge from Pennsylvania. He's a consultant in forms of regional government. He acquainted the commission with several varieties of regional forms of government that are being experimented and experienced with across the country. He said that our form of county government here in New England is certainly the most unique and probably the least regional of any that's being used in any other part of the country. He made an excellent presentation. We had a very lively discussion afterwards, and I think this commission will be doing a lot more investigating and putting together of information before they do come up with their recommendations, but it'll be interesting to follow their progress.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, I just wanted to let anyone know in the public that there's a meeting in Brunswick this Saturday of the Casco Bay Estuary Project, and it's entitled What's the Matter with Casco Bay? Just a brief history. The estuary project in April of this year was given the Casco Bay as a significant estuary in the country and part of the National Estuary Program. The program that's going to take place on Saturday is basically going to be a brainstorming session and also a educational session with a panel of professionals involved in water quality, natural resources, etc. Just trying to identify some of the potential problems or the problems that exist in Casco Bay. And then following that presentation of the panel of experts, there will be discussion of citizens, etc., to try to formulate a loose, if you will, or a package of problems that are perceived to be facing Casco Bay. This will be presented to the Casco Bay Management Committee, which is the headliner of this project, if you will, and It's a 5-year project, and this is just the beginning. So if anyone is totally confused by this statement, show up in Brunswick Saturday. It's 9 to 3 at the Atrium Hotel. If you need any more information, you can call me at home or call the town office, and I'll leave this so that Barbara can give you directions, or Debbie or whomever answers the phone could give you more information on this project. But it's going to be a very important project that's going to direct what Casco Bay holds for the future for all of us.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? Council Jordan.
Yes, I have a couple of things here. I just would like to report that I observe. It's not so much as correspondence, but I want to commend the War Memorial Committee for cutting back some of the bushes there that went around the previous memorial, and they've got it now stand out, so it really stands out and you can see it. I think it looks 100% better than it did in the past, and they put that white stone down there to make the paths and what have you to get to it, and I think it's tremendous. Number two is that I don't know just who done it, but I would like to commend the one that cut the bushes back so Joni Benoit wasn't scratching her knees as she was walking out of the bushes, or jogging out of the bushes. And someday I might find somebody, and I think I'd make the donations if the experts will come around and tell me what should be there, but I feel that some of them green, used-type bushes should be there instead of those straggly little rose bushes, as I call them. And number three is, I have a recommendation here, and I'd like to throw it out to the council to think about. Maybe it should have come up at one of the goals, but it's something that I've thought about for quite some time. I would like to recommend and ask the council to think it over and maybe have an item on the agenda in December, starting 1991, before each official council meeting, that we stand up and salute the flag. And I think it would be tremendous, too. I've seen it done a couple of times lately, and I would think it's something that maybe we should start in 1991 is my recommendation. I'd like to have the rest of you think it over, and maybe we have an item on the agenda in December and to make it official in January. Maybe that isn't the proper procedure, but I would think there should be a vote on it if they're going to continue it in the future. Thank you.
Perhaps even change our town council rules. Council McLaughlin.
Madam Chairman, I wanted to report on my attendance at a Council of Governments Executive Committee last month. They had a very good presentation about the need for phosphorus control in Sebago Lake, which, while it doesn't affect us directly for our land use issues, it certainly does affect all of us because that is our water supply. It was reassuring to get a better feel for some of the measures being proposed for that. It was not necessarily a good feeling to get a feel for some of the cost that's going to go along with it, but that will certainly come in due time. Jane talked about the commission to evaluate county government. That is something else that members of COG are involved in, and that group will be meeting at the COG building, I understand. Another thing, event that COG has hosted recently that Councilor Amaro attended was the local and state elected officials exchange, which was very successful, and COG does hope to have some follow-up forums to go over some of the major issues brought up, and those were tax reform and a better tax mix, workers' comp, education, economic development and training, DEP cooperation and process, and the need for increased participation. One other thing I'd like to bring to the citizens' attention results from a recent ordinance committee meeting. We are sending to the planning board some recommendations that they review the existing roadway classifications. Majority of these, most of them are downgrading the existing street classification. This would have an impact on especially front yard setbacks for people on these streets. Streets involved are Columbus Road, Phillip Road, Dearborn Drive, Wobbin Road, Wombeck Road, and Wheeler Road. One street being recommended to be upgraded from a minor street to a feeder street is Fickett Street. So I would recommend if citizens on those streets have some concerns or questions, they can either get in touch with Town Hall or the Planning Board members. Thank you.
Councilor Crewman.
Yes, two items. The first, a follow-up to Councilor Amaro with respect to county government. The Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee continues to meet regularly. We'll be meeting tomorrow night to fine-tune our recommendations to the commissioners with respect to the upcoming county budget. There will be a second public hearing on December 10th, 1990 at 5 p.m. in the Cumberland County Courthouse. And recognizing that the county budget is about 2.5% of our overall budget, I would encourage as many citizens as possible to make their way to the courthouse on that particular day. Secondly, I would like to make a proposal with respect to the fiscal year 1992 budget process as chairman of the Finance Committee of the Town Council. Having participated in the Cape Elizabeth Municipal School budget discussions for fiscal year 1989, 1990, and 1991, I have personally found this process to be very time-consuming, where difficult decisions are made, and usually all of the people involved at some point are unhappy at particular decisions, or even angry at a particular decision that is made with regard to cuts in the budget. This year, as chairman of the Finance Committee of the Town Council, I've had the opportunity to speak to several of my fellow councilors prior to this evening's meeting, as well as the town manager and the chairman of the school board, Mr. Leslie, regarding the upcoming process for the 1992 fiscal year budget. This year, we all know that the budget process will be very tight. Money is scarce. For all intents and purposes, we are in a recession. Many people are facing economic hardships far worse than last year. And to quote the town manager with respect to the municipal side, we are looking at a quote-unquote significant retrenchment. Listening to the school board meeting last night on the cable channel, we already know that legal fees will exceed the budgeted amount as a consequence of pending litigation. Personally, I would like to coordinate the 92 municipal school budget process in as respectful, fair, and thoughtful manner as possible. The percent of allocation over the last 7 years with respect to the four areas of the budget have held relatively constant. For our current fiscal year, 1991, the town share of the budget is 29%, the school is 65.2%, the county is 2.5%, and the community services part is about 3.2%. This has held rather constant over the last 7 years. Consequently, I would like to propose a possible win-win situation in this difficult process. In the spirit of the one-town concept and in the spirit of parity with municipal and school components of the budget, I would like to propose that we place this issue on the agenda for the December 10th council meeting in order for an open public debate or possible public hearing on the upcoming budget. The school board has asked the council at a recent joint workshop to give them direction regarding the bottom line. And I would like to give that direction prior to the process rather than after the council traditionally receives a dollar request from the school board that would then potentially increase the budget by a dollar amount and create the annual situation where the town council then traditionally asks the school board for additional cuts. I think we all experienced this last year in particular, and I'd like to try as much as possible to avoid the whole distasteful process that resulted. So whether it be an item as a council action or a public hearing, I leave that up to my fellow councilors with respect to the specifics, but I would like to see the process be an open one at the December council meeting.
You don't feel that it's going to be too early to be able to, for both sides, to come up with even ballpark figures?
No, I really don't. In talking to the town manager, I think we have a sense as to where we're going. We should be just about at that time clear from the point of view of the county circumstances. And I think given the fact that negotiations are going on, really, now with respect to the teachers' circumstances and the school system, I think that this would be an ideal time to precede the monetary year.
Councilor Amaro.
What specific things would you ask the public to comment on?
I'd like to hear specifics about whether or not people felt that a specific percentage increase was reasonable in this economic climate. And I'd like to hear the rationale and particular reasons for how people might arrive at a particular increase, rather than, you know, coming up at the end of the process with an unacceptable increase and then having to go back to the drawing board and make very unsavory and sometimes unpalatable cuts. That would be specific input that I would be hopeful to receive.
Manager has a question.
Yeah, I have a question on that. I think, you know, directing that question to the public, I think obviously the response is going to be we want no tax increase. You know, as a taxpayer myself, I could say the same. Do you plan any opportunity for either any school representative or perhaps myself to present a preliminary sketch of what the budget looks like and what a 0% tax increase, how much extra funds might be available or not be available, or whatever percentage you choose?
I would be delighted to receive as much input as possible prior to that day and at that particular meeting. Sure.
I think we have to have a definite structure, or it'll just be chaos earlier in the process. Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I'm inclined to agree with just what you said, Madam Chairman, is that it's got to be structured, and I don't, maybe the school board has got their budget along far enough so they can throw out some percentage figures that they're going to need for this coming year. And I just have a feeling it's a little too early to do this right off. And I don't think that you'll accomplish quite, I believe, what you feel you're going to accomplish. I think the budget should be put together with what the manager or the school board feels that they need to run it. And they've all got a message that this is a tight year and a hard year. And if they don't come in with a budget like that, then I think we are back to the old process. Hey, we got to do better, and we got to go back and look at it. Now, maybe you can, I'm not one to set percentages of how much you can have or going to need or anything. I feel we should put a budget together for the need that we feel the town needs and act on it accordingly.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, one thing that I would suggest for a public input is the town manager has just brought back from Maine Municipal Budgets at the Breaking Point, which is a brochure that's available through the town hall. And that is something that anyone who is interested in knowing before we get into any dollar amounts, some of the restrictions and demands that we have on our budget outside of our school and direct municipal services could pick one of these up, or if anyone would like to call me, my phone number's in the Cape Courier every issue. I'll be happy to send one to you directly.
I just wonder, we had originally planned to meet with the school board in January at that point as far as discussing budget, and if that might not be a better time than trying to do something in December, it would get everyone a little more time to put information together.
Right, Councilor Jordan.
The Councilor Creeman threw out part of it as far as the county budget, but being the chairman of it, we are meeting tomorrow night, and we have met with the county commissioners just recently and throw out some of the figures that we feel that they could change and save, and some other possibilities that maybe they could hire out some work, and it might be even cheaper than as far as maintenance and whatever, and janitorial work might save some money as far as the county budget. Now, whether they agree to it or not, I don't know, but we are sending them recommendations tomorrow night, and they are supposed to act upon them, and as he said, be ready for the December 10th meeting.
Do it, Councilor McLaughlin.
I think Councilor Creelman's proposal suggestion here has a lot of merit, the merit being that we're up front early on with the school board. I think that is something that I personally feel is very important, having gone through the sessions that we did last spring that were uncomfortable, to say the least, and some of them seem to be non-productive. I do think this would be productive. I'm not, you know, being reminded that we're planning to meet with the school board in January would be a workshop setting, I believe, so it would be towards the end of January. If we brought it to a public hearing, a public forum, which we don't tend to do in that kind of workshop, that the earliest that would most likely be then would be February, which is better than we've done in the previous years that I've been involved. That may be an acceptable compromise between the past way of doing it and what I'm hearing proposed for next month. One fear I would have in getting started next month is we prolong the agony. I would doubt that that would happen, but I think there's that potential. I certainly don't want that to happen. And if we were to have something on the agenda next month, as the chairman has said, it would have to be appropriately structured.
Well, I guess, I mean, the bottom line is, do we have, will we have enough tentative numbers to get a sense as to a guide for our work together? I'm interested in public input in the beginning, and my experience over 3 years has been that by the time we see numbers, it's an immediate reaction of, you know, what do we have to cut? So I'm not holding the December meeting, you know, etched in granite as the definite time we have to do this. I do think we have to start much earlier than we've started in the past. And if we want to tentatively arrange a time very soon to do that, I mean, I keep hearing from the school board that they want direction now, that they don't want to wait until January, February. They want that direction right now in the negotiations that they're carrying on.
And in your discussions with Peter Leslie, did you get a feeling that he could have these figures available as early as December?
No, that he himself is not going to have a bottom line to the school budget, but that he would certainly...
He wants us to give him a bottom line.
He'd be, I think, very grateful, yes. But as I say, December is not a magical month. If you feel January is a preferable time to get that on the agenda, that's perfectly fine.
As an administrator, Mr. McGovern, how do you feel about the December versus January?
It doesn't make a whole lot of difference. And on this point itself, I would like to comment. In the past, I've always greatly resisted the type of approach that Councilor Creelman is suggesting. However, looking at next year's budget, I know on the municipal side, you know, the projection is that if we continued business as usual, we would probably have a tax increase in excess of 20%. You know, obviously that is totally unacceptable. And, you know, I would much prefer that we do the necessary groundwork in order to avoid that over as much time as possible, working closely with the department heads and with the town council. I think, you know, with a problem as significant as we have, we have a number of structural issues to look at. We have a number of alternative revenue issues to look at. And my sense is the sooner we get started in dealing with the very real problems that are before us, the better off the council will be able to evaluate the needs of the citizens to have services with the needs of the citizens to maintain some dollars that they spend without sending to the local government.
Okay, do you feel that we could come up with a structure for a meeting in December that would be productive?
Yes.
All right, then perhaps we'll consider, if you feel you can do that, perhaps we should set it for December meeting. Is that a consensus from the council?
Yeah, what you might want to do is a two-step process, is hear the municipal side in December and then give it some thought, hear the school side in January, give it some thought, and then make a decision at a meeting once you've heard both
We have to hear both
aspects.
Councilor Reed.
Yes, I'd like to bring to the council's attention that the school is closed for the last 2 weeks of December. So probably many of the administrators and also many of the parents of school-aged children may not be in Cape Elizabeth to attend a second half of December workshop. The other thing is I have talked with many people and strongly support Councilor Cramlin's suggestion because people do want to give their ideas somehow early on from the general public. And, you know, even if they're not taken into account at a full workshop on a specific budget, at least they will have expressed their interest. The other part of that is there several people have asked that all workshops on the budget be televised. And I believe that that is a budgeted item that the council has control over, and I don't know if this is an appropriate place to address that. And I do personally feel that a budget is a policy statement. And I think that when the public wants to make input, make statements about the budget process, that we should encourage them in any way, and I think it's an excellent idea.
So the consensus, I guess, is that we try to deal with the municipal side in December, since Mr. McGovern's already begun the process.
Yeah, at that point, we'll have all the five-year plan projections in, so that it'll be a good document to work on.
In January, we'll meet with the school board and address their concerns and our concerns in that area as well. All right. Then let's move on to the basic part of our meeting. The first is a public hearing on the sign ordinance. I'm going to ask Council McLaughlin, who's chairman of the ordinance committee, to give us some background. And in this, I want to remind you, this is just a preliminary hearing on a draft of a sign ordinance. That we're not going to be able to answer specific questions for a particular sign in town at this particular time. If you do have specific concerns, we ask you to address them to the code enforcement officer and have them respond to you in writing.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. As you can see, the pile about the sign ordinance gets thicker every meeting here. As was explained, this is what we foresee as the first of maybe two public hearings on the sign ordinance. We wanted a public hearing early on so we could get citizen input. And this is to encourage both those of you who have signs on your property as well as those of you who look at signs on other people's property. Everybody in town is affected by what will be the outcome of the sign ordinance. What we're hoping to do is to replace the existing language that's found throughout the ordinance. It's not in one contained place in the ordinance, and thereby make it easier for people to understand what is expected and what the requirements are regarding signs. It's been difficult for the planning board and the zoning board to make the decisions that they have to regarding signs because of the lack of direction currently in the ordinance. We're hoping to improve on that, and with your help, we will improve on it. I'm not going to go through the specifics. I know the draft has been available to the public, and I know I'm looking forward to hearing the public comment. I will say, if you are not able, for those of you at home, if you're not able to somehow get here this evening for the public hearing and you do have concerns, please make those known to us through either the town offices or put it in writing. You can call the town offices, you can put it in writing and drop it off here at town hall and drop it in the mail. We'd be very glad to hear your concerns. We will be having an ordinance committee meeting the last Thursday of this month at 7:30. You are welcome to attend that and suffer through our deliberations at that time. Thank you.
So this is the point for public comment. Is there anyone who wants to come forward to make a comment? If so, please give us your name and address. Come ahead.
My name is Greg Jones, and I'm manager of Jonesy Service Center, 298 Ocean House Road. And I've come this evening to express my opposition to the ordinance and that is being considered. In my opinion, it is flawed in many ways and far too restrictive for Cape Elizabeth business owners. It states in Article 1 that the purpose of the ordinance is to govern signs throughout the town in the interest of health, safety, and general welfare of its residents. I fail to see a direct relationship between that purpose and the wording of the ordinance itself. It appears there must be an unstated, underlying purpose somewhere. Otherwise, such a far-reaching ordinance would not be up for consideration. This ordinance covers all types of signs, from no trespassing signs to house numbers, yard sale signs to no dumping signs. In my opinion, it attempts to fix a problem that I didn't know existed, and it makes restrictions that will have, in my opinion, a serious detrimental effect on area business. Additionally, I don't believe that town council and the planning board need to burden itself with regulating these signs like pick your own strawberries and so forth, as well as the various window signs that we use on a regular basis as a vital part of our business marketing strategy. I fail to see the need for this comprehensive ordinance, and I feel it will have far-reaching implications, the worst of which would be to drive essential commercial activity right out of town. I'd like to state my specific objections as they relate to me personally. Article 3, Section 21.3-1E indicates that signs with colored lights are not permitted. I'm not sure I fully understand what that means, but in my estimation, most lit-up signs have color to them, and it would be hard to prohibit the use of color. Otherwise, the sign would lack a decent general appearance. Secondly, Article 4, Section 21.4-1 says, illumination shall be from an external light source only. This, in my opinion, is the greatest flaw and the greatest error of judgment in the entire ordinance. In my opinion, internally illuminated signs are usually more attractive and appropriate, especially where a business has a more modern appearance, such as mine. I don't see the rationale in outlawing internally illuminated signs such as you might find on the front of a Coke machine, for example. I would submit to the council that these signs are the ideal type, and they have they're more attractive and appropriate, and to prohibit them would be a grave disservice to the town. Additionally, I feel the existing ordinance is adequate, and I've had firsthand experience with it. Found it is effective in preventing too many signs and too much clutter, especially around town center. I would like to, however, impress upon the council that each business is different, its needs are varied, and those needs should be addressed on a more flexible and individual basis, with the code enforcement officers utilizing the existing ordinances to settle any squabbles that might develop. Signs obviously are expensive and to put up and maintain. However, they're essential items to area businesses, and in many cases they are mandated by suppliers of products and franchise owners. In some cases, national brand specifications need to be fulfilled in order to be in compliance with company policies. These major companies take their names and their insignia very seriously, and if it's not put where they want it and how they want it, it can have negative effects on the business owner. Could result in loss of franchise rights, and in many cases rebate programs are jeopardized to a great extent. I know in my case, if I'm not allowed to put certain signs in certain locations that Mobil would otherwise have, I will be, I will stand to lose a substantial amount of money from the company. I think the ordinance would weigh heavily on an already overburdened code enforcement office and planning board, and I fail to see the need for it. In my estimation, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. I would suggest that the ordinance go back to the committee, the ordinance committee, and have input from area business people and the like to come up with a more appropriate layout. Additionally, one part I missed, in speaking with the code enforcement agent this afternoon, there was some confusion on the square footage that would be allowed, total square footage that would be allowed for a gas station specifically. As I read it, find it. Section 21.4-3, paragraph B, indicates that the total allowable permanent signage area per gas station shall be 120 square feet in area for all exposed faces. The question I would have is if that 120 feet is in addition to the square footage that is already allowed in other parts of the ordinance. As Mr. McVain indicated this afternoon, that 120 feet would be in addition to the square footage that a BA business could already have. So I think the ordinance needs to be a little more flexible. It should deal to some extent with the size of the lot, the amount of road frontage, and I just think it needs to be less restrictive, especially on the local business people. Thank you very much.
Is there anyone else?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Chairperson Coggeshall, council members and town staff. My name is Steve Etzel. I'm the Vice Chair of the Planning Board. Last Tuesday at our workshop, we met for an hour and a half, 2 hours, and reviewed the October 1 draft of the sign ordinance. And I just after a brief synopsis of the looking at it philosophically, I'd like to go down through maybe step by step as quickly as we could.
We do have copies with corrections from your group.
Okay. Do you
is there a major one or two points that you want to emphasize instead of going page by page?
No.
Because we could meet you, you know, in a workshop setting instead of going through 20.
I don't.
Right,
could
now.
You? Could I see a copy of what's that? What I'll, if it's okay. Compare this to with what I have. I was asked to come here tonight and address these different issues.
Right.
Yeah, it's the town planner provided a copy of what you came up with in order to facilitate the process. And
okay.
So, you know, the council would be aware of what the planning board's concerns would be.
Okay. I guess in general we were concerned with the philosophy of bringing a sense of permanence to the business signs and. Realizing it's a zoning-driven ordinance dealing primarily with the business area, but not specifically only with the business area, bringing to that a sense of some simplicity, clearness, cleanliness, subtlety, and some consistency to the signage in the town. Understanding that the sense of competition in the business area drives the intensity of the signs in general. Probably the most difficult as a planning board dealing with probably the most subjective being the style. We felt that as a consensus it was easiest to stay away from a specific style as an ordinance and simply stay with the other items that I previously mentioned. I think, and it doesn't make sense to go down through the definitions and such, but as it applies to further in the body, perhaps it was a feeling of the planning board to take a close look at the definition, for instance, of freestanding and temporary, since further on in the chart you use those two definitions, the two words together. If you read the two definitions together as one word, it's not clear. In other words, if we're trying to regulate a freestanding temporary sign, it's a real complex situation. Perhaps I'll wait till I get to the draft.
So you feel that we have to examine a little more closely the definitions?
I think she gave the planner gave you some suggestion on the changing. It may require even simplifying the definition, for instance, of freestanding more. She did include the corrections that we had there, but it still, if you read it in that changed mode and you put the two definitions together, it still makes a tough definition of freestanding temporary.
Well, we can sort of deal with that in the workshop setting, a committee meeting, along with the planner. But as a member of the planning board, do you feel that some sort of cohesive sign ordinance is necessary?
Oh, definitely. What's existing now is, you mentioned, it makes it very difficult. I fully understand the previous comment dealing with over-regulation, but there is a sense of needing at least some to deal with the planning issues, especially in what we're considering to be our town center, and probably in the next decade will become our town center. I'd like to just to go to page 4, section 21-2-2. And the town planner is we've asked Maureen to do some measuring, and where in the 21-2-2, paragraph B, the consensus one it was that 50 square feet per side tend to be large for an established neighborhood. In just trying to recollect what the existing signage is now, that's why we had her out measuring different signs to see what is sufficient and acceptable. We're bringing this back to our November 20th meeting, and will be there for discussion at that time as well.
Okay.
Some of the specifics.
Well, we appreciate this input.
I guess on page, doesn't have a page, section 21-2-3.
It's actually page 5.
Page 5. Section C. It was the consensus of the board that 25% of the total glass storefront is extremely restrictive, and would suggest that you look at over 50% being covered as a guideline. The other issue that Maureen is working, the town planner is working on, is the height. We're still concerned about the height, anything over 20 feet. Didn't seem to see any need in reading through this anyway, especially the wall sign at 25 feet. Realizing that's a fairly small sign, but the need of posting a sign at a height of 25 feet. The reason for asking her to measure some of the signs, just what signs in the town are over 20 feet, if there are any. Maybe they're not. There is also a sense of that may be in too much consistency, not having any signs more than 16 feet, for instance. It can be just as visually damaging. I'll check to see if she's
I believe she's going to be working with you, isn't she, Councilor McLaughlin?
I know she's doing that measuring. I photocopied some of the dimensions I myself had done on signs around town.
The, turn to page six. The section 21.3-1, projecting and suspending signs, is our consensus that the shingle type sign, if driven by size or restricting the size, is actually an effective way of signage, and there didn't seem to be anything objectionable to, as she says, 6 square feet per side of 2x3 per side. The same being true for roof signs, and this may require some work back in the definitions. Certainly understanding the implication of roof signs being projecting from, standing up from roofs, but again, it was a consensus that signs that integrated as part of the roof were acceptable to the planning board. Just in section 21.4-1, the explanation of scratching the two or three colors plus black and white, the sense that two poorly used colors can be worse than 16 well-used colors. It didn't seem to be a reason to regulate the number of colors. Section C, we didn't really understand. We had some fun with that. Our copy.
That was a very strangely worded.
Yes, the base of freestanding pavement. We could imagine.
That was a test.
Yeah, it's to see if we're paying attention, right?
Sure, they read it.
Word processor.
I guess, as far as input from the planning board, the next issue would be on paragraph D, and I think it will come back to the planning board on the 20th, dealing with the elimination from external light source. We spent quite a while talking about that, and it came up again at the very end on removal of non-conforming signs. I think what I'll do is just address that at the end of dealing with non-conforming signs and our sense there. One of the previous comments dealt with gasoline stations, and I think the comment had to do with in the area where it states in paragraph B, 21.4-3, paragraph B, or in the area for all exposed faces, and I think if that's changed simply to the aggregate, that is more clear, at least to us as a planning board, would be more clear. The last issue has to do with in most of the time that we spent having to do with removal of non-conforming signs and how we foresaw that process, whether it's a 5-year, basically an amortization period where during that time period people remove the non-conforming signs. And the implications and some of the problems, if just financially, what that might do to some businesses in town, and if there's any liability to the municipality, if, for instance, it's a $10,000 sign with a 10-year amortization and we're asking them to conform to a 5-year amortization, who's responsible for the balance at 5 years? The similar type concerns came up with non-conform uses, continuing until the time that any change is made. That had to do with being more specific about what does the time that any change is made. Is it a matter of the change of the non-conforming part of the sign? In other words, if it's an internally lit sign, if changing the interior light bulb, does that institute change of the non-conforming part? You have to be real specific. What in the long discussion of those two different approaches to removal of non-conforming signs led us back to the eliminating signs, and I think on the 20th we'll discuss if the 5-year time period is not, and it wasn't a consensus of the planning board that they thought that, it was a good idea to eliminate it to a 5-year period, perhaps we will look further at the illuminated internally illuminated signs. Is there something we can do to regulate the internally illuminated signs so that they're more acceptable to the town and the town center? Again, we spent almost 2 hours on it last Tuesday, but we'll be bringing back to the 20th Planning Board.
Thank you. Thanks. I think there's also an alternative to that of just grandfathering non-conforming signs that are existing when this goes into effect.
I will say for your benefit, we did have a business owner speak at the last meeting about the internally lit signs. Mr. Tinsman shared with us his initial shock at the brightness of his own sign, and that I think is one thing that we may want to look at. Again, I appreciate the concern for being specific on that, and how do we enforce something like that if we're going to institute it. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Hi, I'm Martha Porch from the Lobster Shack. And I have a couple of concerns about the sign ordinances. Our sign is suspended. And I think it's a rather nice looking sign. We take it down every year to store it in the wintertime. Does that mean that we could never put it back up again in the spring? And I don't see any reason why we need to change it in 5 years to attach it to something just so that it was not suspended. Also, I've just briefly looked at this ordinance, and I don't see in here where it allows us to have a sign at the end of the street that would help customers find the restaurant, one of those DOT signs that attach onto the pole that's not obtrusive, that would help customers direct people down to the restaurant. Other than that, I'm sure there are some other things that might be of concern, but those are my two basic concerns, is the fact that we'd lose our suspended sign, and it doesn't say in the ordinance that we could have an off-premise sign. Speaks of strawberries and of fish farm, but not of restaurants or of inns in the ordinance.
Thank you. Is there anyone else?
I have a store in Cape Elizabeth also, and
would you please tell us your name?
Leslie Ferguson.
Thank you.
And mine is only a year old, and so I had to go through this process last year of getting signs. And when I did, I mean, I just couldn't put up anything. I mean, I had to bring in plans to the code enforcement from the sign builder. I was told how much square footage I could have, and I'm not sure how the ordinance reads. I mean, I never paid attention to it, but I know when I had to put up signs, you just couldn't put anything up. I mean, there's definitely limits, and there's definitely restrictions already. The other thing is, when I was looking at what you said, not permitted, I would say this covers just about every business here is either a suspended sign or a roof sign or a banner. I mean, you hit just about every business. There's very few businesses that would have anything other than what you say here that would not be allowed. And I have a thing to do with the colors, too, because your Cape Elizabeth sign is about 7 different colors right there. And it's a beautiful sign. I don't think you can be as limiting as what you're trying to do, because then there's absolutely no leeway at all. And I also would have to say that I think a lot of the signs in Cape Elizabeth are really nice. I happen to think my sign is very nice. And I know a lot of other stores here, their signs are nice. But businesses still have to survive, and they have to let the public know that they exist. And we're a residential area, but you're still allowing businesses, and if you're going to allow businesses, you have to allow them to advertise and let them know they exist, or you can't. We're too rural, we're too out of the way here to have signs that are just flush against the wall and are so small that people don't know you exist.
Anyone else?
My name is Tony Costopoulos. I own a Good Table restaurant. I kind of agree with the young lady back there. All the signs in Cape Elizabeth are pretty well done, and how many businesses are we concerned about here? We all try to obey the law in putting up our signs, and a couple of times a year we see signs saying strawberries, put on even my land, open houses of real estate, lobster dinners at the churches. Are all these going to be all excluded now with these laws that you, I mean, with these things you're trying to do? And I think just being, it's just, we're trying to do a good thing in this town, all the businesses are. And we're all, you know, I shut off, I have neon sign, I shut off at night, and that's about it. I think all the towns in, I mean, all the businesses in town are trying to be ordinary and be straight, really. Okay, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. McGunn?
I think, not that all the points sound interesting, but I think Mr. Costopoulos brings up a particularly interesting point on some of those, like, church signs that you see that go up, you know, a lobster stew or something like that. One of the problems that we have, and one of the reasons this ordinance is proposed, is right now none of those signs are allowed at all. The strawberry picking signs that you see out there are prohibited. The church supper signs are prohibited. The real estate open house signs at the end of the road are prohibited. And people come into this office day in and day out about different issues. They've had a bad day or whatever, and they come in and they say they have no right to have that sign there. We therefore have to send our code enforcement over to the church saying, you got to take down that sign. You know, we feel like fools, to be blunt. And one of the attempts in this ordinance, I think is something very helpful, is that it's attempting, maybe it's not succeeding, but it's attempting to allow those types of signs that people traditionally have not found objectionable, and to try to represent a wider community interest instead of just the one person who comes in that happens to find something objectionable someday. And I think, you know, that's a lot of the emphasis in this ordinance, is to take a lot of what we have out there and to codify it so that a lot of those things people don't find objectionable are in fact permitted.
But are the businesses in Cape Elizabeth that pay the taxes and we thrive in the summertime, okay? That's the bulk of our business. The Lobster Shack, myself, Kettle Cove, the Fish Farm, all of us thrive in the summertime. You're telling us now that you don't want us to put up signs to make a living. That's a reality.
It doesn't say that.
I think one thing that's being said, and I think the point the Porch has made, Mrs. Porch, is the issue of off-premises signs. And, you know, some will pick this up and say it doesn't allow it. The town has never allowed it. And, you know, I think that's another example. One time, Mr. Ledbetter very innocently put out a sign at the end of the road there, and the neighborhood was in an uproar. It's going to bring more traffic down here. It's going to do this. It's going to do that. And, you know, I think the council has to listen to all the concerns and balance all the different concerns.
Well, our concern as business people is almost every business here has hanging signs. And if this thing passes, you're telling us we have to take them all down?
No. If they're non-conforming, a possible solution to that is grandfathering them, which is seemed to be the way the discussion was leaning more in the last ordinance meeting. It doesn't say that.
No, thank you.
Is there anyone else?
My name is Joan French, and I have a business in Cape Elizabeth also. I guess I'm here to express my bewilderment by the ordinance. But it's quite an extensive ordinance, and I understand your concern to make things more clear to people. However, I think that in all fairness, considering how extensive it is, it would have been perhaps nicer for the ordinance committee to notify businesses that an ordinance change was in the making. Perhaps they don't understand that even the most simple sign costs hundreds of dollars, and then more complicated ones run up into thousands of dollars. So it's not a whimsical thing that you can change your sign. I know the Main Street 90 committee did a very nice job of sending around notices to the businesses near the town center asking for their input, and I think in all fairness the ordinance committee, considering the extensiveness of this ordinance, should have done the same thing, and then perhaps should get cooperation as opposed to people polarizing themselves. Again, I express also my concern about the colors. That doesn't really seem to follow much logic to it. again, your own town sign is a good example. It looks beautiful. The other one that concerns me too, although it doesn't affect me, is the suspended signs that are supposed to be coming at an angle from a wall or a building sign. There are a good number of businesses in Cape Elizabeth that have that, and I think they're very attractive. They're a very effective way of doing it. I know right next door to me, the dentist has one, and that's not an offensive sign. A lot of times, signs like that can be, they can have smaller signs, they can have an interesting shape to them, they present a sense of character within a town. I know that Cape Elizabeth is always concerned to have a sense of character and a nice atmosphere about it. Well, that's usually how you obtain that, by getting creative signs that are come at angles to businesses. The other one concern is on page 5, you noted that signs would have to have a ground clearance on freestanding permanent poles, a minimum clearance of a ground clearance of 8 feet. That's pretty high. I mean, I don't know if anyone really thought about it, but that starts making us look like highway signs. If you go along Route 77, there are a good number of signs that do not have a ground clearance of 8 feet, and yet they're very attractive signs. If you stuck them up to have a ground clearance, if my understanding is correct, that means the bottom part of the sign would have to be 8 feet tall. That really will change the rural character of Cape Elizabeth. You start looking like highway signs. So I guess we simply ask that perhaps you can work more cooperatively with businesses. I do, as everyone else has stated, I think that most of the signs within Cape Elizabeth are very attractive. Most businesses are interested in keeping a nice character of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to come forward and make a comment? If not, I'll close the public part of the hearing. Move on to item number 91, to consider a proposed sign ordinance and take any necessary action. Discussion from councilors? Councilor Reed?
Yes, I had a question regarding scoreboards. The ordinance is silence on scoreboards, and I'm thinking primarily of town-owned property, the schools, Little League, and Lions Field. I'd like to know if that could be addressed, please. And the other consideration that I had is, I think there are 39 signs in Cape Elizabeth, and could someone indicate to me how far off I am? Anyone? Establishments with signs, excuse me.
Yeah, I think there's quite a few more than that if you look at the total context of everything the current ordinance is designed considered to be a sign.
I'm sorry, I'm still looking. I found two I didn't like, and I think it is, a lot of it is a matter of taste, and I understand the reason for something to enforce, but I if somebody could come up with approximately how many signs there are and how many would be non-conforming, I would appreciate that information sometimes. Thank you.
I think the non-conforming bit may be difficult based on the changes I foresee coming in the next ordinance committee.
Someone might have noticed my smiles that you're going to give comments, Councilor Reed. One of the problems is, you know, some people would tell us that every Portland Press Herald on the side of their plastic boxes constitutes a sign. So, you know, it's tough to come back and say we have, you know, I could come back and say every street sign and every stop sign, and I'd come back with 1,000 signs.
So I'm not trying to be hard to get along with that. I really am trying to find out what constitutes a sign, like the vending machines and things like that. I'm just trying to get, I'm not on the ordinance committee, so I can ask those questions, right?
You can ask any question you want, whether you're on it or not.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Pearson, did you have your hand up or not?
A few of the speakers mentioned, I was going to bring up under reports and correspondence on observations of how nice the town signs do look at Tarbox Circle and the one on the number one firehouse. But I also wanted to make known to Mrs. French about the input factor why the ordinance committee, I think the ordinance committee, Janet, or Wayne, whomever, can confirm this, they want to come up with something so that you can comment on instead of getting brainstorming first. So at least there's a structure to the ordinance, and it gives you a basis to go and correct certain aspects. They've done a lot of work and appreciate that. And I think another intent of the sign ordinance is not for the local businesses that have signs, but one of them is also, you don't want every person from the country saying, geez, I'd kind of like to locate a business and come with a sign and already preconceived notions that they're going to do this, that, and the other thing. I think most of the residents of Cape Elizabeth do also own those businesses, so the Cape residents own the businesses in town. And I think that there is a sense of community, and I think that the signs are, for the most part, very nice and in keeping with the community spirit. And, you know, I think that's one of the things also that the ordinance wants to address, is to keep that so that everyone is responsible in the signage. One thing that Greg brought up about the companies requiring certain signage and whatnot, I think that for the most part, national companies would be more receptive if we did have a restrictive ordinance to make adjustments to certain towns, as they did in Freeport with McDonald's and whatnot. They want to, I think, coordinate their affairs with the town so that they're better community-oriented versus saying, forget it, we're going to take our franchise and go elsewhere because you're not doing what we want. You know, so I think, you know, this is just a start, and it's not saying we're going to, you know, take away franchise rights and everything, but I think that if it did come to pass, that the companies involved, as you mentioned in your situation, would be receptive to and say, well, we stand behind this community and we're going to change things a little bit. Steve Etzel's, can I go on? I'll stop. I was just going to, the last one was about the internal illumination. As Tom Tinsman brought up at the last one, where he was kind of shocked by his brightness of a sign, but he would be willing to shut it off. Tony had mentioned that at night he did shut off a sign. And I think that on certain internal illuminated signs, that might be part of the ordinance, that it could be certain voltage so as not to cause excessive glare, etc., and to have certain requirements when things are shut off, including Coke machines, although I know Councilor Jordan thinks that if someone wants a cold drink, they should know where to find it.
That's right.
Okay.
And stop. Thank you.
Do we have any other comments, or are we going to have a motion on this item? Councilor Jordan.
I'll make a couple of comments, and I'll also make a motion at the end of the first, whichever you wish. My comments are, getting back to the managers, maybe that day that person came in got a bad day at picking strawberries, so I'm not saying that.
They were at Maxwell's.
No, I thought these all pointed at me. They're always good at Maxwell's, it's just a joke. And the strawberry signs you brought up, but I know that they just use it for an example. But I just wanted to point out to the people here, and I think as a member of the ordinance committee we overlooked, because I had a call tonight about why the businesses weren't notified of these sign changes. And the idea of this meeting here was to get some ideas from people, and maybe we should have notified them more so we could get more ideas, and I just hope that they'll write in some ideas, and so we can put an ordinance together that you'll be legal. We want you all to be legal one way or the other. Now, maybe we won't be able to satisfy you all, but I think we'll make it more uniform, and everybody will have a legal sign up, but the strawberry pickers, I guess, because I got to get down to the end of the road. And one other thing, it gets so nitty-gritty when you get into signs, is like Councilor Pearson just said a minute ago about my Coke signs and Pepsi signs and these machines around. I just happened to bring that into an ordinance committee meeting one night that we were talking about signs. I said, what are we going to do with those? So I come up with another one while I was sitting here. Do you figure the sign where you have your name on the mailbox as a sign, or what is that considered? And
only yours.
Only mine, that's right, because it says farm on it. Yours just put your name on it. And there's one guy spoke to me, and I think it's awful that you have to get a little bit illegal to get a sign, and it's stretch the law to get legal, let's put it this way. So he put a sign up, part of it, and then he moved an inch and put the rest of it. And that made him legal. They give him two signs by certain square footage. But he done it by putting it an inch apart. And I think we want to correct those situations when he put up a sign that is legal. So I'll make a motion that this is referred back to the Ordinance Committee.
Second the motion.
Councilor Creeman.
Just a couple of points. As a member of the Ordinance Committee, I just wanted to try to convey to the public that we do not meet as an Ordinance Committee as three disgruntled municipal officials trying to annoy business owners or homeowners or anyone else. In particular, this particular sign ordinance, and we got away from, I think this is like 7B or something. When we did the wetlands and went through 18 drafts, we just decided to not let people know how many times we went over this. But this whole thing has been driven by the Zoning and Planning Board. I mean, for years they have struggled with these issues and haggled over particular signs, and as a benefit to them and as a request from them, we have tried to address this issue. Secondly, although I don't want to get into debate, Joan, lest you think we're complete dolts about the new town sign with the many colors, we did attempt to exempt that one in particular. Section 21.1-2, Section D, that was going to be exempted, lest you think that was going to have to come down. And lastly, some of the input that I've received recently, and I'm delighted that we reached 66% in the recent election, but I've received a fair amount of input with regard to the political signs that have dotted the landscape of Maine, and more particularly in Cape Elizabeth. Billboards were outlawed years ago in Maine, and billboards have returned to the political scene, as you all know. And I don't know if we can, as a municipality, override the state, but I would like to see some kind of relatively small, uniform political signs being put up so that there was not the obstruction to traffic, as some letters to the editor indicated occurred in Cape Elizabeth. I think that'd be reasonable. I'm not yet convinced that in any political documents, numbers of signs really leads to victory anyway. But when one is there, the other party feels there's a need to match it. But I would hope we would try to consider a size issue with respect to the signs we've had. It was in this day and age of such scrimping and recycling, to see that pile of 5,000 signs in Portland that was getting recycled, I think was a lesson to us all about excess in this day and age. So we're happy to take this ordinance back to the Ordinance Committee and go over it again and again until we can fine-tune something that can be as acceptable as possible to the town.
All those in favor of the motion to have the Ordinance Committee review and perhaps incorporate some of the recommendations this evening? Opposed? 7-0. Our next item is a public hearing on the unsafe structure of 130 Ocean House Road. We are going to have Mr. McGovern, and I believe, is it Mr. Daigle who's here from the Code Enforcement Office on the unsafe structure? To the background. This is Tom, Mr. Leahy.
Madam Chairman, just to put this in perspective before Mr. Daigle comes to the podium. This is a proceeding by the municipality as opposed to in court to determine that a building in this town is structurally unsafe and to take the appropriate remedy. And what I'd like to indicate, first of all, is to the town council is that all of the required notices have been given. I have prepared an affidavit from me as a town attorney as to those notices. I do not know whether there are any parties in interest here this evening. Those would include the owner of the property as well as any party who may have a lien on the property, but they've all been properly notified of the proceeding, first of all. Secondly, we updated the title as recently as today, and there are no further parties in interest. The applicable state law requires the town to, through the town council here, to make a finding this evening. So just so that it proceeds properly, I believe it would be appropriate to have Mr. Daigle speak to you to, if you will, testify, to provide you a basis for making a finding. You could also have Mr. Daigle submit to you evidence by way of photographs, what have you. The conclusion after that would be for you to take a vote, adopt findings of fact, and I have proposed to you a draft of such a motion. Ultimately, before you all leave tonight, if you do approve that draft order, you will need to sign it. And I will take care of some of the details after that. It needs to be recorded in the Registry of Deeds. It needs to be served upon certain parties. So it's a little bit different. For those of you who haven't been through these before, we have to make, and the reason I jumped up first is to make sure we go through those requirements. So I think the process would be to have Mr. Daigle present evidence, to ask if there's anybody else here, owner or otherwise, who wishes to present evidence, then if you deliberate and adopt a motion with those findings. Thank you. And I'll be available to answer any questions now or later on in this proceeding.
Mr. Daigle.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the council, and citizens. You should have before you an order that pretty much describes the state of this building. For those of you who are not familiar with the building, it is located at 130 Ocean House Road, and I have these photos that would pass among you, if you would look at them. These were provided by the Cape Elizabeth Police Department, and Sergeant Lindsay is the photographer. And he takes awful nice pictures. At least they prove the point. The reason we are requesting that this building be condemned is basically the building is deemed to be unsafe. It's has not been a dwelling as such whereby anybody has lived in it since 1974. In fact, I went over the file a few days ago and recall that the last person we had removed from that building in 1974 ultimately came to work for the town as a maintenance type person. And that was the end of the use of that building as a single-family dwelling. And since 1974, the file is filled with instances where we have notified the owner that the building has been unsafe, dangerous, left open, and that has continued on to this time. There was, in 1987, a building permit taken out to renovate the building, and an attempt was made to do that, and we all saw that as coming along. Of course, recently you've seen the windows completely removed, we're going backwards. So this is basically the reason that the building is unsafe. It is there's no attempt to keep the building locked or at least boarded up. The foundation has lost its integrity and has began to collapse. We were in the building today and we were not, as we're going up to the second floor, Ernie McVeigh, the court officer, said, I don't think we should be both on the stairway at the same time. Along the second floor, it is held up by timbers that are starting to rot. There are holes in the floor where people could fall through and hurt themselves if they weren't careful. There are all kinds of signs of abandonment, and it's becoming a health and a safety hazard. For this reason alone, we're asking that the council, through this public hearing, also agree with us in proceed to remove this dangerous building. With that, I would entertain any questions that you may have.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes. Is this one thing I want to ask? The information that you've just thrown out to us, as far, do you have that documented so it can be within the files within the town? of what you found today when you went through it? Does the manager have a copy?
Yes. What I'm reading from Councilor Jordan is a letter, is the order that you should have...
I got the order there.
Okay, I'm reading from that, basically on page 2.
I think it went beyond what I saw here.
I editorialized a little bit.
Okay.
What I was reading to you was the history of the building backwards, and only going in it today to reaffirm that these conditions are still existing.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. McGovern.
I'd like to amplify on one point that Mr. Daigle has made, and that's that this has been a continuing problem since almost 1974. I've worked in this town now 12 years, and I can remember discussion after discussion after discussion with the code enforcement people, with the previous town manager, as well as with myself, about this particular home. It was formerly owned by Mr. Udell Bramson. The town repeatedly asked him to fix this building. He would make very few cosmetic type repairs and would be back to the same old thing again. Jerry's file, you know, documents all of that. There's a long-standing record of, you know, of assurances from the property owner that they would, in fact, oh, we'll make the necessary repairs now. I think, you know, what's happened is that they've kept doing that as the building, as testimony Mr. Daigle indicates, has actually the structure, the foundation, the very being of the building has become unsafe. You know, I personally met, I don't remember the exact date, but a year or so ago with Mr. Steve Corey, who was the current owner, and at that point he told me that he was going to be fixing it up and cleaning it up. And I was given all sorts of assurances. We were given a definite date of when it was going to happen, and it still hasn't happened, and it's well beyond those deadlines. You know, I'm extremely concerned that, you know, that there could be another 11th hour appeal. And I think the track record for this building has indicated that particularly the previous owner of it, who was also the lien owner, has not been cooperative with the town and has continued to allow, while he lived, a very safe, unsafe condition to continue. Also, I would like to note, I don't know if the council has it in front of them, but we did receive a letter either today or yesterday from Mr. Steve Borey, who is the current owner, indicating that he wants the building torn down, that he agrees that it ought to be done, and that the only, and we had had discussions with him about the fire department taking it down, and the only holdup had been that the Bramson estate had some concern over it. If the council doesn't have the letter, maybe I should read it to you for the record. As owner of the property located at 130 Ocean House Road, Cape Elizabeth, I have continually worked with Mr. McVeigh to keep this property from being a hazard. I also had given my permission to him and the fire chief to remove the building as a fire training exercise. I had the insurance removed, and I still agree to let them take this building down. It has been Mark Bramson who has refused to sign off on this matter, so I contend if your ruling is to take the building down and there are any expenses, that Mr. Bramson should be held liable. Thank you, Steve Porey. The process is, however, contrary to what he says here, if the town council does order the building down, the town would accomplish it and the cost would be placed as a lien on the property.
Any other questions of Mr. Daigle? Is there anyone from the public who wishes to make a comment? If you please come to the microphone and identify yourself.
Chairman Coggeshall, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Patricia Peard, and I am probably the 11th hour appeal that you're worried about. I assure you I'm not an 11th hour appeal. I represent the estate. I'm a party in interest. I represent Mark Bramson, whose name has just been mentioned, who is the personal representative of the estate of Udell Bramson, whose name has also just been mentioned. Mark Bramson is a resident of Michigan and cannot be here tonight. He's asked me to represent him for the council. I am not here to ask you not to find this building to be what it clearly is for the town of Cape Elizabeth, which is a nuisance. I've been through it myself. It's disgraceful. My client has only asked me to come here tonight to tell you that we currently have an order from the court which will reinstate us as a mortgagee. on the property. That order will become final on the 1st of December, at which point we intend to begin foreclosure action on that property. My client only wants to tell the town council of Cape Elizabeth that he regrets the actions of his father, which did indeed cause you a lot of difficulty, and he wants to assure you that it is his intention, if the foreclosure action goes through, to try to cooperate with the town, to save the town money, if that's possible, in seeing that the lot is cleaned up, and that it is his intent to see that it's properly sold, and that hopefully it will become a productive piece of property in the town. And so I'm not an 11th hour appeal. I just wish to assure you that there is a Bramson that does want to cooperate with the town, and we are available to do that in the future. Thank you.
And this Mr. Bramson has received notification from the town?
Yes, he has. That's why I'm here. We have had formal notice. Everything's appropriate. We have no complaints. We're not asking you not to go through with your action tonight. I'm not here to forestall you or stop you. I think you've been forestalled enough. My client just asked me to please just convey that to the town council, that he hopes to be cooperative and wants to help with the process of making it a productive piece of property in town again, as opposed to what it currently is, which is embarrassing for him in light of his father, who's now deceased, and obviously for the town. Thank you.
Any other people from the public who wish to make a comment? Mr. Leahy, do you want to give us guidance on this latest bit of information?
Well, I believe, Madam Chairman, that the essence of the last comment was that as on behalf of the mortgagee, does not object and is not really submitting evidence, but rather concurring. I understand that the person, being really in a state, has a lien that may be foreclosed in the future. This process won't change that. What will happen is if the town goes beyond securing the property and demolishes the property, the building, and removes it, there may be more costs incurred, which would be a lien on the property. But I don't see that there's much by way of an alternative. I think alternatives are to secure or to demolish. So I think that the foreclosure that was alluded to may, in fact, continue to go forward without really affecting your process or your process affecting that. They really are two independent matters. Someone will own the building later and will own the property later. They may have a lien on it for whatever cost you incur. I think that's the essence of it. But other than that, I think the findings are, or the order is ready to be adopted, and I think it was adequate testimony as to the facts.
There being no further comments in the public part of the hearing, I'll close it. And we'll go on to item number 92, to consider finding that the structure located at 130 Ocean House Road is unsafe and take any necessary action. Do we have any comments from councilors? Councilor Krillman.
Well, I walked through the building, too, and it's a disaster, and I think it ought to be taken down. My question is to the town manager, if we demolish this building, it's going to cost us money, at least temporarily, to knock it down and to dispose of it. Where's that money going to come from? And we're going to deal with an outside firm to do it, and how long will it be before we get reimbursed for our cost?
I think that there's two issues there. One is, we would utilize the fire department as much as possible once the snow on the ground, and with the reason to wait snow because the grass is dry and who knows what might happen. But we'd hope to use it as a fire department exercise, therefore saving ultimately the property owner money. The money in the meantime would simply go would be created as a receivable, and as the notice that Mr. Leahy prepared states, we will make a demand on Stephen Pori to pay it. If it's not paid within 30 days, we'll assess a special tax, and the special tax goes with the property. Ultimately, if anyone does have interest in doing anything with the property, the town will collect. But the money would come simply from, you know, the setting up a receivable. There isn't a specific appropriation. My only other point is that if we do sign this order, perhaps the most important word has a typographical error. On page 2, it shall be town down. I'd prefer it to be torn down, just so that we don't end up footing the bill ourselves.
I believe Mr. Leahy has a clean copy for us to sign, where the correction was. Yeah.
Great.
Correction. Councilor McLaughlin.
Question to the manager, please. How much money are we talking about?
You know, we'll look to see how many firemen show up. We'll take their compensated average rate per hour. You know, they come volunteer firemen. It's a very low rate.
So I keep hearing.
In addition to that, there's been some discussion of perhaps helping the process along by doing some bulldozing prior to in order to control the fire. I understand someone has indicated that they're willing to help out with that in the interest of assisting the fire department. I haven't heard that directly, so I don't want to state the name publicly. But, you know, the costs are minimal. And then the plan would be to push the foundation and to put the remains inside the foundation and to put some cover material over it to make it safe. So it's, you know, we're not looking at all that much of a cost, you know, particularly with utilizing the fire department resources. I think the other, it's... you know, if there's any good that comes out of this, the fire department could use a good training exercise.
I will agree with you on that point. Are we talking under $500?
I wouldn't want to be pinned down, but you know, it depends on what equipment that we need to rent to go in there and clean it up. But you know, I'd say we're definitely talking under $1,000. But
I
wouldn't want to be. The $500 makes me nervous.
I gathered that. Thank you.
Is there a motion on this, please, on this particular order?
Madam Chairman.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I move that we find the structure located at 130 Ocean House Road to be unsafe, and that we approve the order as corrected this evening.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? None opposed. 7-0. The next item, a public hearing on dead-end streets. I'll ask Councilor McLaughlin, Chairman of the Ordinance Committee, to introduce this particular ordinance.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I think the easiest way to deal with this is to read the proposed ordinance language. We are dealing with specifically dead-end streets. The proposals before the council and the public hearing this evening result from discussions held in ordinance committee. We've had input from the fire chief, the police chief, the public works director, planning board through the town planner. We've had at least one local developer in attendance at our ordinance committee meetings, and we've had input from the town manager. The proposed ordinance reads as follows. Dead-end streets shall be no longer than 1,000 feet in length unless the planning board determines that a greater length is necessitated by the unique layout characteristics of the land or by the specific site conditions, including but not limited to wetlands, surface water bodies, rock outcroppings, designated scenic areas, or significant tree stands, and that the greater length will not impair traffic safety or emergency vehicle access. Dead-end streets longer than 500 feet shall have underground utilities. Dead-end streets longer than 1,000 feet shall service no more than 20 dwellings. A dead-end street shall be measured between the points where only one means of access exists.
Comments from the public? Comments from any organized bodies? Any bodies? This is getting late already.
You haven't even got started on the agenda.
Barely, yes. There's no one who wishes to make a comment on this as proposed. And I'll close the public part of the hearing, and the council will go on with its discussion. My objections to this new wording have not changed since it was first presented, that the planning board has complete latitude as to the final length of the road, and that we need more clearly define exactly what we mean where only one means of access exists. Does it not include Esplanade? And how is this really an improvement over what already exists? Since we have the professionals of the town, the fire chief, the police chief, the public works department, director, all feeling that this is not in the best interest of the town, as worded, I would like to see either more clarification or have us just stay with what's already there. Any comments from anyone else? Councilor Pearson.
Madam Chairman, I too, with the opposition from the fire chief and the police chief, can't support this in its loose terms, if you will, that it can be determined the greater length is necessitated by unique layout characteristics. Along the road will take down less trees and give you a better view. That's, you know, that may be unique. I don't buy it if it sacrifices the safety of any of the inhabitants on that road at all. I can't support anything like this. I don't think it should be left alone or delete that under no conditions can it be more than the length as stated.
Other comments from former fire chiefs or present ones? Councilor Crewman?
Not a former fire chief at all.
You raised your hand too soon.
I guess I did. 1,000 feet is arbitrary, and I'm not big on being arbitrary in these kind of issues, but in reviewing the several letters from the fire chief and police chief and quite a fervorino by the town manager at one of the private discussions here, as well as from the podium with regard to the considerable dangers over 1,000 feet in length, and Michael having brought up several times where limbs and or fire trucks and exposed hoses have really been problematic with respect to public safety. I personally cannot vote for this particular change either.
There are no further comments. I'll take a motion on this ordinance change. Councilor Jordan?
Well, I'd like to just add a couple of things there that evidently I didn't understand when this was drafted, that the idea of a greater length of 1,000 feet was to get around a rock outcropping or a stand of trees and maybe some wetlands. So as a crow flies, you wouldn't be in there more than 1,000 feet, but the road might be a little longer. And I thought evidently my mind didn't work in the right direction. That's the way I understood it was going to work. And not so uptight about the 1,000 feet, because the problem is roads have been put in before with the idea that they was going to be extended, and then new phases come along and new writing gets put in the books and they don't get extended like the original plan. So I think it's pretty hard to sit here and say that no road can go beyond 1,000 feet, because sometimes they have to go in the next phase of the project would connect it up, and with the idea of connecting it through. So therefore, we would if the project was going to go forward, we'd have to make sure the road was put in all the way through to the next main drag before it could even be started. And I don't quite look at things that way. I think if they want to go in a ways and what I would call a temporary 1,000 feet, they should be able to do that. And if I was going in 1,000 feet and that's it, I think you'll have to take the project in consideration and look at the layout and look at what is going to add to it or extend it or never extend it. And I think you can have a good project by doing it. So I think they should be extended, if possible.
I believe that is sort of the latitude already that the planning board does use that rationale in some of its approvals. Is that right, Mr. Edsel? That you do have a flexibility of going around certain natural configurations so that you can extend them sometimes.
I think to the contrary. They now have an ordinance which reads, in no instance shall a dead-end street exceed 1,000 feet and service more than 20 dwelling units. My sense is that the no, that's current. Mm-hmm. My sense is that the current planning board has followed that fairly religiously. In the past, I don't think the planning board was reading the ordinance. There's a number of instances where that is not followed at all, even though it's been in the ordinance for a long time.
Councilor Reed.
I just would like a clarification. The ordinance proposed as read by Councilor McLaughlin is the same one that was opposed by the fire police and public works department heads. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Could be no further comment, Roy. Could be a motion on this item.
Speaking of
why didn't you come forward as a public person when you had the chance? No, we'll let you speak.
I am in some measure.
Would you?
My name is Bob Taylor, and I'm principal of Stonegate Associates, and we are land developers here in Cape Elizabeth. And I am in some measure responsible for the appearance of this issue in front of the board, in that I made a specific development proposal to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board, and the planning board and I looked at this proposal in the light of the ordinance and said, you know, we could do a better job here if we weren't constrained by this 1,000-foot absolute limit. I gather that the objection I have heard is that the planning board might run off willy-nilly approving dozens of very long streets where it would be inappropriate. My suggestion is that the language of this ordinance might be revised simply to say that streets in excess of 1,000 feet be allowed where a waiver be approved by the town council. And that would bring before this body those few instances where it was an appropriate approach from the good planning sense to have a longer than 1,000-foot street. Thank you.
Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I'm not going to give my whatever Wayne said I gave at the last meeting, Councilor Cramlin. But just for the very briefly, I think for the benefit of everyone, I think what the staff is trying to avoid, and in a one graphic instance, we have a development subdivision that was approved, I think it was about 7981, by the name of Cranbrook. You go into Cranbrook, for those of you that are familiar with it, it's all private roads, and Belfield Road is one that connects eventually to a dirt road, which I believe is known as Allen Road. Going off to the right, off of Belfield Road, is Cranbrook Road. Cranbrook Road, I would guess, goes on for a good mile without...
It's not a mile.
All the way to the end of Stonebridge Road. It's pretty close, Councilor. It's got to be three times in excess of 1,000 feet. And on that particular street, and I'll keep this very short, I actually did see an incident when a fire truck was stuck in there and couldn't get out. A branch had fallen in back of it, and you know, not only was the fire truck stuck there, but everyone else was stuck in there. They couldn't get out. And those instances happened. There was no other way out of that. And I feel strongly about this issue.
How many houses are there on that almost mile-long road?
I would...
That's a lot. Lots.
My recollection is that there's around...
Almost 40.
Almost 40?
Okay. Then it's a mile.
On Cranbrook?
Cranbrook Drive and Stonebridge
Just
Drive.
On Cranbrook?
No, I'm sorry.
No.
The whole development's close to 40.
Down that way, it's probably 20, 20.
I would say half of it are going to be along the Cranbrook.
So these things do happen.
I know they happen. They could happen at a 500-foot street. So you have to live with those things. And the idea of the ordinance years ago was they had to widen out where they brushed out and where they cleaned it out. So if that branch did come down or that tree did come down, it was supposed to be far enough out so it wouldn't block the whole road and it would only get part of it. And I think now that you've gone on to that subject, and it's one of my pet peeves that the roads are too damn wide and laid out, and they clear out too much of them. They should be closed in a little bit more and not have such a wide turnpike type road in the town. Let's bring them in. We had a nice one that way, the Lewitt, which is Pickett Street.
Okay, we can get back to that section of the ordinance at another time. I think right now we are on dead-end streets, per se, and possibly amending this section of the ordinance. So if we could please have a motion on this item, or we'll be here till 1 o'clock.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I move that we send this proposed ordinance back to the Ordinance Committee for revisions to reply to the comments made this evening.
Thank you. Second motion.
All those in favor? Item number 93. Item number 94. To consider report from the Planning Board regarding infrastructure needs and take any necessary action. I believe Mr. Etzel is here from the Planning Board, and he was chairman of the subcommittee that drafted this report. Is that correct? Would you like to come forward, please?